Well, it's a real privilege to welcome all of you to an evening with Barrow Global. It's not often that I get to start a new program at a venerable institution like the Barrow, and this is really special because in the last year we've launched Barrow Global, and this is really one of our first public events to share this initiative with the community, the Barrow community, but also the community at large. This is a picture just to get us in the spirit. I haven't seen my wife yet. I don't know if she's here. But one of the things I like so much about this picture, there are two things. One is that she took it. So she's an amateur photographer, and this was from one of our Mission Brain trips to Guadalajara. But the other thing I like about it is it just captures the spirit of medicine outside of the United States. We've gotten so used to private rooms, fancy equipment, super clean environments where the top doctors work and the best care is delivered. And it's just not that way around the world. What you see in this room is about 50 people in this long room, all squeezed together. There's barely enough room to get to the next bed. Patients' families actually sleep on the floor or underneath the beds so that they can be with their family member who's in the hospital. And you have to work in this environment. So it's a reminder that we're not all as fortunate to practice in the kinds of hospitals that you see here at the BNI. Barrow Global is really about addressing disparities around the globe in healthcare delivery, and also to improve the quality of neurological care worldwide. And to borrow our motto from Mission Brain, it's to treat, educate, and empower. I've always liked that that saying. I just want to begin with some acknowledgments. I'll begin with Katie Cobb and the BNF, the Barrow Neurological Foundation, and Sarah Burns for putting this together. They really answered the call and did a lot of work to get all of you here, not only in this room, but we have a Zoom audience that's over 100. So there's a lot of people here and a lot of effort that went into this. I want to thank the BNF board and particularly Mike Hekimovich, who is out there. He's been instrumental in so many things and has been to our place in Africa and really helped to develop our global effort. The Frankie family, Dave Frankie is here somewhere representing, there he is, in the back. None of this would be possible without Bill and Dave and Carolyn and the Frankie Foundation and all of their interest and support. More about that in just a minute. Next is the Women's Board. Part of my motivation to do this was because we invite these wonderful speakers for the ball, which is tomorrow night. And rather than have them just come and go, this is an opportunity for everybody to meet them and to hear from them. So the Women's Board is doing yeoman's duty probably now, trying to pull this event together. And so a lot of them can't even be here because there's so much work that goes into that Barrow ball tomorrow night. But I did want to acknowledge all their work from that they're doing for the weekend. Next is the honored guests in this front row. You'll meet them all, and I'll introduce them as we get to that. But thank you, all of you, for taking the time out of your busy schedule to be here. We've also invited a lot of ASU Thunderbird students. I don't know how many of you are out there, but thank you for your interest and support. We're really looking forward to collaborating with you more. I wanted to acknowledge Gabrielle Finley Hazel. If I don't see her, but if she's here, thank you, Gabrielle, for the support. And of course, our real leaders for the BNI, Robert Spetzler and Volker Sontag, who helped not only take care of the Frankie family when they needed them, but then followed that up with cultivating their gift to us. And then finally, the Barrow community. It's a real privilege to just share with you what we're up to, because I think a lot of you may not know all the activity that's happening here. So just a few comments about the Frankie Global Neurosciences Program. This was a transformational gift of $21 million. That's so rare in this day and age to have that much and be given to one place. And this is Bill signing the documents for this. And his mission and the foundation's mission was to educate and train future leaders in neurosciences, both at home and developing countries around the world. They were interested not so much in brick and mortar, but in the human development. And so they wanted to develop this education center. They wanted to have these dollars go to benefiting people And so we have a range of Frankie Fellows. These are neurosurgeons who come, research fellows, scholars who come and study from all levels, from high school all the way up to attending neurosurgeons around the world, and interns in high schools locally and beyond. And so there's just a range of ages and a range of levels of training, and they're all being funded by the corpus of this gift that will go on in perpetuity. We have courses in Latin America, and the Frankies are keenly interested in Latin America. And then, of course, our first beachhead out there is in Kilimanjaro, and Dr. Elagala will talk about that later. So anyway, those are my brief introductory comments, and I want to just get on with the program and introduce Gail. Gail will be our first of three keynote speakers. She is professor of neurosurgery at George Washington University. She is our first adjunct professor in this program here. She was just appointed chairman of the G4 Alliance, which is a big deal. She's the global section editor of one of our two key journals in neurosurgery, the journal Neurosurgery. She's also on the World Neurosurgery Board as a global champions editor. She's involved on other executive boards, World Federation of Neurological Surgery, FIENS, and the Think First group. And lastly, and I think remarkably, the AANS Humanitarian Award is no joke. This is a huge honor. It recognizes people who go above and beyond just being neurosurgeons, but really recognizes people whose goal is to change the world. And I think there's nobody who exemplifies that better than you, Gail, and your work is really inspirational. So welcome, and come on up and give us some remarks.
Great. Thank you so much, Craig. Michael, thank you for those very kind words. As I've said before in this space, I can say this because I wasn't trained at Barrow, and until the last year, I wasn't on the faculty here. So I can say that Barrow is the best place. That's objective. That's not subjective. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be able to make a difference, as you said, with Barrow. And this is the place to make a difference. And I hope that that my remarks here, prefacing these outstanding speakers that you're going to have, will convince you of that as well. So thank you for that. I'm so delighted by the launch of BNI Global and proud to be a part of it. But that's not only for me or even for my specialty. As Michael mentioned, just recently I was elected the chairman of the board of directors of the G4 Alliance, which is the federation that represents all surgical, obstetric, trauma, and anesthesia organizations. And I can tell you, as a neurosurgeon, that neurosurgery is leading the way. And I was telling Mr. Frankie earlier, I think that this is a very good investment, because an investment in the best place of neurosurgical practice is an investment in neurosurgery, which is leading the way for global surgery and for all those people. And you'll see there are a lot of them who don't have access to even the basic emergency and essential surgical care. So we stand on the shoulders of giant philanthropists, giant master surgeons, like Dr. Spetzler, Dr. Sontag, Dr. Lawton, and I'm so pleased to be able to work with Dahlan Elagala as we move forward together. Well, you've seen this, so I'll move on. But we're building a global community, and this is the first time you may have seen this digital postcard, but it won't be the last time, because at the end of the day, although neurosurgery requires high attention to high tech, it also is high touch, and it the end of the day, it's us forming the Barrow Global community with our bilateral relationships that are formed on MOUs and non-disclosure agreements, and yes, on digital postcards from Dahlan and Gail visiting Kenya and sending it back to all of you, that we're going to be able to make a difference. So let me start. My job here this evening is to be sure that we're all starting from the same place when we're talking about what global surgery or neurosurgery is. It's a distinct discipline within neurosurgery. It's the clinical and public health practice of neurosurgery with the primary purpose of ensuring access to safe, timely, affordable neurosurgical care to everyone who needs it. So as the world has become global in the last 30 years, we as surgeons and as neurosurgeons have acquired a second core responsibility. And in addition to that responsibility that we've always had to take care the best possible care, in fact, of the patient in front of us, we now have a second core responsibility, which is to support those efforts around the world to bring that high-quality care and education to colleagues who want to provide that care to everyone everywhere. Why is it that we're hearing so much about global surgery now? Just in the last 7-8 years. And this is why. This slide has everything you need to know from the most cited paper in surgery, not just neurosurgery, surgery today. It's the Lancet Commission report on global surgery from 2015, which started all of this emphasis on academics, metrics, and systems in global neurosurgery and surgery. This started with a call to action from the World Bank for nations to make the case for why investments in surgical care were important. And what they found after 2 years of study is that 5 billion of the 8 billion on our planet lack access to surgery, 143 million urgent surgical cases are not done every year because there simply are not enough human resources or capital resources. The costs are astronomical. But here's the important thing for the people who are savvy business personnel in the audience. Yes, it will cost a lot to scale up, and the Lancet Commission estimated that it would cost $350 billion to be able to bring quality surgery to everyone everywhere. But the lost GDP, if we don't make that investment, is on the order of $12 trillion. So we simply must do it. So our challenge as neurosurgeons, recognizing that 5 billion people don't have access to surgery, which translates into more than 5 million urgent neurosurgical cases that aren't being done each year, and a need for 23,000 or more new neurosurgeons right now. Nobody trains neurosurgeons better than the Barrow. This is what we need to do. And you might say, well, yeah, but that's a really tall order. It's maybe taking on too much. It's biting off too much. Well, let's look at the example, the very recent example of our colleagues in the pharmaceutical industry. This is the CEO of Pfizer, Dr. Albert Bourla, whose 2022 book, Moonshot, described how his industry in just 9 months made that messenger RNA that has saved so many millions of lives and hundreds of millions of people from getting sick. And what did it take? It took 9 months of work by a company largely led by this man, who's a Greek immigrant, the child of Holocaust survivors, and Dr. Bourla is a veterinarian. But he feels that what he had and what they had at Pfizer was courage, excellence, equity, and joy. And we have that in abundance in our field and here at Barrow. Well, in these next few slides, I'm going to share with you the inspiration that I take for our moonshot from the words and the vision of President John Fitzgerald Kennedy. So where you see these next few slides, where you see words in italics, they come directly from his famous September 12, 1962 moonshot speech at Rice University, where he said, "Where there is strife, prejudice, and national conflict in the world, these should not exist," and it's my words in bold, "in healthcare, which provide endless opportunities for peaceful cooperation. But why, some say, should we care? Why choose global neurosurgery as our goal?"
We choose to go to the moon in this decade.
I hope you can hear
the
that.
Other things. not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win.
So we like the fact that this challenge is hard. We're neurosurgeons. We like things that are difficult. And Kennedy goes on, we choose to take on the challenge and responsibility of, in our case, providing access to quality neurosurgical care for everyone. We choose to do this not because it is easy, but because it is hard. Because this goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept, we are unwilling to postpone, and one that we intend to win. Our obligations to ourselves and others, as well as others, require us to make this effort to respond to these challenges and to solve the problems of access and quality on a global scale. The growth of our science, Kennedy continued, and education will be enriched by new knowledge from previously silent voices and untapped environments, by new techniques of learning and mapping and observation, by new tools and new paradigms. Our trainees and our institutions will reap the harvest of these gains, and we cannot be deterred. No specialty and no nation which expects to be a leader can expect to stay behind in the quest for the highest quality healthcare of all its people. And our instruments must include shared knowledge and advocacy for enlightened scientific and social policy. So I take inspiration from JFK and the space program, and I hope you will too. Kennedy in that speech cited the arrows we have in our quiver to be able to accomplish this task. Our vast scientific knowledge, we have that in neurosurgery. The rapid progress we've made in recent years, and our mental strength. The unanswered challenge and this unfinished work that our challenge represents must stimulate our collective energy and resources and indeed our imagination. So for all those reasons, I believe, and I hope you will too, that global neurosurgery is our moonshot. It's our challenge for our times. So let me just spend a few minutes going over what we have already that prepares us to be able to win. As Kennedy said, as we've just said, we intend to win. We have shared knowledge. We have educational programs, great simulation. We saw wonderful examples of cutting edge aspects of this today. New healthcare delivery systems, field clinics and hospitals like KCMC in Africa, like the next place that we'll have in Latin America, and so on and so forth on every continent. And an economic focus of doing more with less. And two specific things that speak to education that I think are very important. Two papers we published last year. The first one is about targeted public health training for neurosurgeons, an essential task. We want to be sure that our residency programs include the aspect of not only learning how to be the best at taking out an AVM, clipping an aneurysm, but also how to be a leader in your field and to accept responsibility for changing access and improving quality of neurosurgical care everywhere for everyone. And that means educating our own workforce. And also imagining ways to be able to scale up using the tried and true Halstead model of mentor and apprentice. It's going to take too long to close that 23,000 neurosurgeon gap. So we have an NIH grant pending. Our first fellow here, Carrie Vaughn, helped write this, and we're looking at new ways to be able to train more people around the world better and faster. Our instruments include wonderful journals, and this is an important part of Barrow Global too, because there's virtually nobody who publishes or commands the literature in neurosurgery more than the Barrow does. So you're all familiar with our major journals, JNS Publishing Group, World, and so forth. But there's a new section in the Red Journal, which is specifically devoted to global neurosurgery. It's the first time this has ever been done in our or any profession. I'm honored to be the editor of that section, and I hope that we, together at Barrow Global, will populate that with wonderful, important, cutting-edge work. And this is the editorial board of that section that has senior and less senior neurosurgeons from each of the continents. We also need to become experts in advocacy, patient-centered advocacy. So I referred to WHA 68.15 when the world came together in 2015 and every nation voted to strengthen emergency and essential surgery. We've also developed a group called the Global Alliance for Prevention of Surgery, and we have responsibilities of leadership. So where have we, what have we been able to do in the last 4 or 5 years? I work in Washington. We are very involved in advocacy with the U.S. government, and we've actually been able to get funding for $100 million in the U.S. budget in order to support global surgery. USAID is a partner, and they have a significant budget, as you can see there. Our advocacy through G4 Alliance is at the level of the United Nations, ECOSOC, the World Health Organization, and so forth. The G4 Alliance we've just mentioned, and there are many neurosurgical organizations that work with us, as well as other SOTA, surgery, OB, trauma, anesthesia organizations, so that we can coordinate global efforts. So let me just give you some examples as I start to wind down here of what kinds of things inspire us to work together. So this came from South Africa. One of our colleagues is the chairman of surgery and a neurosurgeon in Cape Town, reported on the high level of births with spina bifida in Ethiopia. And that's related to something that shouldn't be. That's lack of folic acid in the diet. And this led to the development of a neurosurgical organization called the Global Alliance for Prevention of Spina Bifida F, which has published, networked, and I'm very pleased to tell you that the first ever neurosurgeon-sponsored resolution is with the WHO Executive Committee this week and likely to be voted on in the May annual meeting of WHO. We have collaborators from Latin America. This is Dr. Kemal Gottney, neurosurgeon, PhD in translational medicine, at a cabinet meeting of the Colombian government, which has an all-of-government, full-in approach, and they are the sponsors of that resolution. These are some details that, in the interest of time, I'll skip over, but the point is that neurosurgeons need to know these details of where advocacy is needed and exert pressure. Costa Rica, interestingly, is a global leader in this. They have a single-payer health system and one group of neurosurgeons who treat every case in the country. So we've learned from them that policy works. Colombia has work to do, and it was neurosurgeons teaching the government, pediatric neurosurgeons who are taking care of patients, teaching the government what policies they needed and what science would work. This is the cutting edge of global neurosurgery. Publishing an article in The Lancet, but not just publishing it, but exerting pressure on their editorial board to take it off embargo and publish it in time for us to get it to every minister of health at the WHA meeting in Geneva. So we've learned from the CDC, developed our own infographics on this, and you can see it makes a difference. We don't need this legislation in the United States. We've had it for 20 years. Our pediatric neurosurgery residency or fellowship programs can hardly field enough cases to train people because we've been able to follow the science, and it's our responsibility to help others do it as well. We work with a World Health Organization. This may seem to younger people in the audience like, well, neurosurgeons have been doing this all the time. No, we're only 3 years into having a neurosurgical delegation at WHO, but it's never going to stop. We have a big tent, a multifaceted team, and we've got a medical student who is the face of this effort. So there's so much more work to be done, addressing the problem of global traumatic brain injuries, and we're starting to address that as well. And then the final thing that we have going for us to help us with this great challenge is the access that we have as neurosurgeons, and you in particular as Barrow. We have access to the College of Surgeons of East Central and Southern Africa and can help raise the bar and access the opportunity to train the next generations of surgeons in Africa where they're so sorely needed. And some of you know this, the fact that the neurosurgeon who was the president of the European Association of Neurosurgical Societies dared to ask himself and us the question, is the Vatican helping us? What's their position on global neurosurgery? No one had ever dared to ask it. He wrote a letter and got an audience with the Pope 2 weeks later, and that's bearing some fruit. So we're welcomed by colleagues for all kinds of collaborations. We have resources, not only the NIH, which you see on the left, but we've got NHS resources. Barrow has enormous resources, many thanks to the Women's Foundation, the Women's Board, the Frankie family. USAID is becoming a partner. My own institution of GW, we have grants as well. So I hope that we can follow the lead of other major universities in North America who are making investments in education, like the University of Toronto, which actually has a tenured pathway to full tenured professor of global neurosurgery, global orthopedic surgery, global ENT, and so forth. And they have now six faculty tracking to tenure on that. So as I close, I'd like to say that of all those instruments I mentioned that will help us meet this challenge, our best instruments by far are our neurosurgeons, our students, residents, fellows, our future neurosurgeons who are already here at Barrow doing so much. So here's a great example. We learned through meetings of Barrow Global that Barrow, amazingly, has had 622 international observers to date. That's not counting all the residents, all the fellows. These are observers. So now we're looking at building that community. How did that opportunity that these lucky individuals have translate into more education locally, better patient care and access locally? Here's another ongoing project that we have as part of Barrow Global, the WHO Surgical Safety Checklist, which is the model for our Barrow Rounding Safety Checklist project. We believe that by helping organize the transfer of patient information around the world in neurosurgical rounds, we'll be able to save lives just like the WHO Surgical Checklist has. We have great opportunity to have major impact in Latin America through the work of Arno Bennett and others. And our student, Elsa Nico from UIC, an observer spending a gap year here, has just published a paper in Neurosurgery Open Access on the current practice of neurosurgery in Albania, rounding out our appreciation for what the needs are of Eastern Europe. So to conclude, I hope you'll enjoy this video. Who doesn't like a launch video? And I'll share this with you. Apollo 11 headed to the moon.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
If JFK and NASA can do it, so can we. With that, I thank you very much.